My name is Larry Shears. I'm a graduate of Mobile County Training School. I was an athlete at Mobile County Training School, played four sports here. I was a part of the state championship team here at Mobile County Training School, which a lot of people know about, and people in the area really supported us during that time. After graduating from county, I went to Lincoln University in Missouri on a football scholarship there. Played 4 years there. I played running back, defensive back. After my career there, I was drafted by the Atlanta Falcons. Played 2 years with the Atlanta Falcons and played 2 years in the World Football League. And after that, that was my athletic career was over.
One of the things, Larry, we want to talk about is who inspired you to play sports?
Well, just the guys in the neighborhood. When we were coming up, when we left elementary school, we came directly to high school. So in seventh grade, we were at county. And, the tradition at county. Plus, we played what we call outlaw football all over the neighborhood. So you see a lot of guys that were playing on the high school level playing football. So, it was something that when I come up, it was just the next step. No one had to come and tell me to come go out for football or whatever. It was just something that you wanted to do because you saw other guys doing it. So that's what inspired me. Just seeing the guys doing what they did, and I wanted to do the same thing.
Were there some siblings or other relatives or other individuals in the community that you looked up to as a youngster, even in elementary school?
Well, my cousin was 5 years older than I was, so I kind of ran around with him. So I got exposed to playing various sports with the older guys then. So that's how I came connected. The guys that were my age, most of them was at home, when I was out, playing baseball or football, basketball, or whatever, with guys 5, 6 years older than I was. So that's how I got exposed, and that's where I guess the competitive edge came from, just playing with the older guys.
What sports did you play in high school specifically, and what do you think were some of your best sports?
Well, I started out playing baseball. Matter of fact, it was just a fluke by me playing baseball. I was watching when I was in the ninth grade. I came over to watch them practice, and they didn't have enough players, so Coach Harden asked me, did I know how to play baseball? I said, yeah. So I went out, and he put me on third base. And when school started, I was starting third base in ninth grade. So that's how I started playing baseball. But with my experience and what Coach Harden saw in me in baseball, I went out for football, and he immediately brought me over to defense, because I wanted to play running back. But Coach Harden had me playing defensive back. So in the tenth grade, I was starting cornerback in the tenth grade. So, and then it just grew from there, and just playing with the guys who had been there for a while, and you just gain confidence. You can see what you can do, how you can compete with different people, guys that were in a different class than you are, and it just developed from there. But I think football was my best sport, but when we were coming up, you played basically everything, you tried anyway,
right.
Played all the sports.
What do you consider your greatest athletic accomplishment in high school?
I guess winning the state championship was the main thing, because it was you did it with your teammates, We summer before our senior year, It was a group of us, about 30 of us, decided we were going to have summer school at county. So we decided we were going to go to summer school. And during summer school, we go out and practice on our own. We just go out and ran plays, did different things. And that just kind of built a trust in each other that we would, take our summer and go, and do this. So That's what was important to me, that our team, the team that we had, we accomplished what we did, Not me, our team did that.
Were there some other characteristics about that team, that group of guys, besides sports? As I remember, Maynard Bull Campbell had all of us to buy a hat. It's a green hat. I don't know if you remember that. And we also were expected to be neat and clean.
Right.
There was a
It was just some different things that we, different people thought of to do, but it kind of brought us together. You know, it built a trust. You know, we on certain days we would dress a certain way. You know, we try to do things together. You know, most of the guys that was in our real core group, I mean, we hung out all the time, you know, at each other's house. You know, if we went somewhere, we were together. And it just built the trust in all of us. And the fact that, you know, it made us, we wanted to do the right thing for everybody, you know. We wanted to make things good for everybody, in the sports thing. But that just was one phase of, you know, in our classroom. You know, we helped each other, and it had its rewards. You know, it really did.
Okay. Were there all white high schools you would have liked to have played, in particular your senior year in high school?
The only white high school that we even paid attention to was Wagner, because it was, you know, basically right across the street. But as far as playing, you know, it never dawned on us. You know, we were having fun and having enough competition playing the schools that we played, you know. But there was nobody, you know, bringing up that conversation, you know. It wasn't a conversation where, you know, would you all want to play this team or whatever. They weren't talking like that then, you know. Very seldom you even came in contact. I couldn't even tell you where Viger played their games at, you know, because it really, I wasn't interested in it. Mm-hmm. We had our own thing, and you know, and we were making that happen for us.
During your senior year, and I think you probably remember this year, Scott Hunter was at Viger, and he played quarterback. Mm-hmm. And do you remember the kinds of write-ups that were given in the newspaper with the two schools at that time?
Oh yeah. You know, I was a big sports. Looking at the sports page, when I was coming up, that's the only thing I read in the paper was sports play, you know, because we used to keep up with baseball, you know, professional baseball. Hank Aaron was doing his thing, Willie Mays, you know. But after, like on Saturday mornings after we play a game, you know, sometimes, you know, it might be an article in the paper about what we did, but it was always something in there about, you know, especially Viger then, because Viger, you know, they had pretty good teams then. So we would see, you know, just different kind of articles, you know, in terms of what was in them and how much was in them, you know. Mm-hmm. But it was something that, like I said, that didn't bother us either, you know. Mm-hmm. But after you get older, you start thinking about stuff like that. But then, you know, as far as what was covered with some of those guys, it wasn't the same thing that was covered with us. We might have an article, a little small article in there, and then they might have your name misspelled or something. But you know, that didn't matter.
What were some of the practice facilities and equipment like when you were in high school?
Well, I mean, it was what it was. You know, we got, you know, your shoes, you. With some shoes some other guys had worn before, you know. Every now and then, you know, we might see some rebuilt equipment, you know. But I, you know, never saw any new equipment, you know, stuff that you can consider that it was new, you know. It was just always something that had been rebuilt, or we, you know, because we used to take our shoes home and clean them up ourselves, you know, shine them up. Do whatever we had to do to it, take our clothes home and wash them, you know. But as far as equipment, I don't think we had any new equipment.
Well, what do you consider your greatest athletic accomplishment in college? And also, when you went to college, did you go into a different experience than you had been in high school?
Oh, yeah, definitely. when I went to college, you know, first of all, to answer your first question, me graduating from college, that was, you know, that wasn't athletic, but that was I considered, you know, one of my best accomplishments. But as far as going to a different environment, it was a long way from home. That was my first time being that far away from home, and the school that I went to, it was predominantly black school, but we had about a 35% black white population. So, but our campus was basically black, but our classroom experiences, you know, it was interracial, and that was different, you know, because I was in class with, you know, with white kids, you know, and coming from this environment during that time, you know, we didn't have that experience, so you know, you had to make the adjustment of, you know, and it wasn't anything big, because you know our parents taught us you know, the right thing to do. So it was just a matter of being exposed to something, and then you adjust to it, and that's what we did. You know, but as far as the athletic thing, I think we may have had, my first year we had two white kids on the team, so the team was predominantly black. You know, and as far as, you know, the competition got a little bit different. You know, you had a lot more good athletes, you know, on the college level, and the game sped up a little bit. But other than that, you know, it was just the fact of being away from home was the biggest thing, you know, trying to get adjusted to not being at home and, you know, not having someone looking over your shoulder. You had to do it yourself.
Do you feel that race may have played a negative or positive influence on your sports career from high school to college?
Looking back, I, you know, if you had asked me that question when I was, you know, going through that experience, I would say no, you know. But looking back, you know, I can say that it probably did, but you can't put a measurement on it, because I don't know, you know. But more than likely, based on what history tells us, it probably did.
Now, I know that you and Gabe Coleman, and both of you went to Lincoln together and graduated mm-hmm. together, had an opportunity. One of the teachers or one of the coaches had written Coach Bear Bryant mm-hmm, because yeah. of your guys' successful senior yeah. year. Mm-hmm. You want to share a little bit about that?
Well, it was Ms. McCants. She came to us, and I don't know how it came, you know, how the idea came about, but she said that she was going to, and I guess Coach Rose had something to do with it too, I would imagine. But she said she was going to write a letter to Bear Bryant, you know, telling him about Gabe and myself. And she said she did that, and she received. And I never saw the letter, the one that went or the one that came back. But she said that she was told that Bear Bryant said that the South wasn't ready for black athletes. This was 1967.
You had indicated that you played with the Atlanta Falcons. How did that come about in terms of your experience with that, in terms of getting signed?
Well, when I was in college, like I said, I started at defensive back my freshman year. So I played defensive back for 4 years. You know, and part of my senior year, I played running back. But mainly I played defensive back. So after my senior year, you know, scouts came out and we ran times for them. And I was supposed to have gone to a pro day down to Tennessee State. But I didn't go because I had found them, so I didn't want to miss my found them. So I told them that I couldn't come, you know. And that was Atlanta scouting group was down there. So so I was surprised when I got drafted by Atlanta, because I didn't even go doing, you know, run for them or anything. But the process, you know, I don't really know what, because we didn't do, you know, we just played, and we didn't have anybody, you know, pushing our name. You know, people just came, you know, scouts came and they watched a few film, and then I had some guys that had played before me had been drafted, so that may have had something to do with it. But whatever process, we didn't go through any particular process as far as having scouts come out. You know, scouts came when they got ready, if they thought someone was there that they wanted to see. We didn't have any public relation people, you know, throwing our name out to different places. And, you know, as far as we had film, but it wasn't like it is now, you know. The publicity thing wasn't like it is now. The media wasn't like it is now. So it was just, you know, I guess, like they said, if you can play, somebody will find out that you can. Somebody will know that you can play. And that's the only way I can explain it, you know, because I didn't do anything. I didn't write anybody. I didn't call anybody. It's just, you know, when they had the draft, someone called me from the newspaper and said I had been drafted by the Falcons. And that's the only thing I knew.
You had an opportunity, and we both had an opportunity to grow up around some guys who went on to play professional balls in different areas. Did those guys like Cleon, Benny Crenshaw influence you?
Oh yes, oh yes. Like I said, we went to all the games, you know, baseball, basketball, whatever. And I saw these guys playing, you know, when I was in at Whitley, you know, we used to come. It was such a big deal when County started practicing during the summer for football. I mean, to me it was, and it appeared for the neighborhood it was, because man, it'd be so many people out there on the field watching, and then don't let anybody tell you they're gonna have a scrimmage. Man, it would be like you at Hartwood Field. It'd be so many people. So you know, even when I was real young, I used to come over here, watch them practice, and like I said, you see more athletes out, you know, just out in the field playing, you know, playing outlaw football, you know. So we used to watch all that, and you know, when you're coming up, you just said that's, you know, you wanted to do the same thing those guys were doing.
Now, I know we played most of our games, we typically played at Hartwell Field. Mm-hmm. What was that experience like for you to play in Hartwell Field? And then we played one game particularly at Glad Stadium.
Yeah. Well, it was, you know, you can look at the facility was a lot different. You know, the field were better. You know, you had grass, and, you know, Hartwell Field, you know, they had the infield you had to deal with. But, you know, It always puzzled, you know. After a while, you start thinking, you know, why do we get just one chance to play on this surface, you know? But that's the way it was, you know. But I don't know if it would have made that big of a difference playing at Last Stadium as opposed to playing at Hartwell Field. But you know, the experience was different, you know, because the facilities, you know, in our mind, was better.
Do you have any compelling stories that would be lost if you don't tell those now that you can think of?
Are you talking just in athletics, periods, or just football, or what?
It's football or in general.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I know my first exposure to organized football was when I was in eighth grade. We, one of our teachers, Mr. Webb, he had a team over at Pritchard Park, you know. So, but he had been doing this, you know, long before I didn't know anything. So I was in Mr. Webb's class in eighth grade. So he just come in there. I guess he had run out of players. So he told me, said, son, you want to play some football? I said, yes. I said, I thought it was going to be over at the school. So he said, at Pritchard Park. And I started thinking, I said, I know every time we go to Pritchard Park, they run away from over there. So I had to really think about doing that, because I was going to have to walk over there, because my parents weren't going to take me over there. So me and one other guy, we went over to Pritchard Park, and Mr. Webb put us on the team. I started out playing center. That was my first position. I played center. So After about the first quarter, I told him, I said, Mr. Will, I can play others. I can play other positions. So he put me on defense. I played maybe a defensive end or something, you know. And by the fourth quarter, he had me running back. I started playing running back. I must have run about 10 touchdowns. Yeah. So from then on, Mr. Will made sure that he would take me over. He would take me to Old Pritchard Park. But every time that we, soon as we finished playing, we had to, you know, gather all the stuff, and we had to run. We had to run from Pritchard Park all the way over to about to Larry Drive. We couldn't stop. I mean, you had to keep going, you know. So you done played football, and then you still got to run back home, you know. But you know, it was an experience that taught me if you want to do something, you know, sometimes you have to take chances, you know. And I don't know what would have happened if we had gotten caught, but I wasn't worried about getting caught, you know, because you know my main objective was to get back to the house, you know, and I did. So that was one thing that kind of made me understand that athletics is more than just getting out there on the field. Sometimes you have to go through other stuff just to even get an opportunity to play. And I'm just talking about this was, you know, eighth grade football, you know. So a lot of times you have to deal with things that you don't want to, but if you want to do stuff, a lot of times you have to go through it and decide if that's what you want to do.
Mr. Shears, explain a little bit more about Pritchard Park for people who may not know of it at that time.
Well, Pritchard Park was a park where, you know, it was in Pritchard, and it was mainly, you know, black people. They had a swimming pool, they played football there, they had baseball. It was organized. People had different. They had softball over at Pritchard Park, and it was just a place where teenagers, young kids, go play and go have recreation. You know, mainly during the summer, but during school hours, they had park leagues. You know, and at the time, you know, we didn't have a park. We didn't have a park out here in Plateau or Magazine Point. So a lot of things that you did from an organized standpoint, you had to do it from Pritchard Park. But it was. You know, Pritchard and was a whole different area, so we had to, you know, deal with that element. But you know, once you became an athlete, people, you know, they give you a little more room, and that's what Pritchard Park. But my first encounter with Pritchard Park was going to swim, and then, you know, as we got older, we started playing baseball, football, whatever, and we would go to Pritchard Park to do that.
And Larry, you talked about coming from Pritchard Park, and I was with your guy. We were with you on some of those occasions that we all had
exactly,
to run.
Exactly.
So, well, we had to run twice, though. We had to run from the guys we played,
right.
And then when we got to Larry Drive in,
right.
We had another situation.
Right.
You want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, Larry's Drive in was an area where a lot of the white kids hung out, you know. And it was on Bay Bridge Road, and it was in between Pritchard Park and where we live, you know. So a lot of times, you know, especially if you were undermanned, if you didn't have a big group with you, you might have some kind of encounter with some of the kids that hung out there. Now, I don't know who those kids were, whether they were in school or what, but they were, most of the time they were kids within our age group. Sometimes they were older, but it was just something that, When you walk down that way, you had to have your head on a swivel, because you know somebody might throw something at you or say something to you or even try to have a physical confrontation with you. You know? But like I said, I never knew anybody to get hurt coming down there. But you know, there was a lot of times that we had to either run or protect ourselves.
Larry, I got a question. You started out early, recognized as an outstanding athlete,
mm-hmm.
And so you had others supporting you, but there were other players during your period,
exactly.
who were outstanding athletes.
Mm-hmm.
who may not have had the support or the drive or the inner thing that you talked about. If you want to play, you can play. Can you talk about some of those players who you came along with who were outstanding, who didn't get the opportunity that you got?
Oh, yeah. It was a number of them, man. I'm telling you, like I said, when we go up to what they call now Kid Park and we play, they were there. You know, you saw them. But for some reason, the discipline part, like Coach Rose, Coach Harden, Coach Clark, they didn't play that. You know, you had to do it their way, or you weren't gonna play it. They didn't care how good you were. But guys like Herschel Hill. You remember the Hill boy? One of them played with us. Jimmy, I think, what was the?
Herbert
played with us. Herschel was a better athlete than he was. Remember Pop Robin? Mm-hmm. Now we played, that's who, when we went over to Pritchard Park, me and him went over there. But he was a better baseball player. He was a piece of pitch. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when you get, if you aren't driven to do something, you know, and you get people who are, if you don't do it the way they want you to do it and you can't handle that, then you just fall off, you know, just fall out of the way. You decide you're not going to do this, you know. But when we're just playing unorganized sports, and so these guys stood out, man. I mean, they were athletes. I mean, it was a number of them. I remember Herbert Park. Now he was small, but he was good. He was a good athlete, very good athlete. And I talked his father into coming to play football. You know, because we played in our backyard together. And I knew what he could do. And I had already been out there. And I knew what the competition was. So he said, "Man, I can't go out there. I'm too small." I said, "Man, you can play. And he came out and ended up and played offensive end, ended up playing defensive end, and became one of the best track guys, you know, that came out of camp. So, you know, that's a lot of times when you do stuff and the guys that you hang out with, Manny Cam, I got him to come out, Hammond, all these guys, they came out because they saw me out there. And they said, you know, and we all played together. So, you know, we played over here together, so we can play out, you know, in organized sports together too. So, and then all of us became real good friends, you know. So it was a number of guys that, you know, that because I was out there doing it, they followed my name.
Theodore Spradley was who you were talking about, referring to.
Right.
There are two questions I want to kind of elaborate on, Larry. One question is talking about the academic strength of our coaches. Mm-hmm. One of that aspect of it.
Wow.
And then the second question I want you to talk about is looking at other teams that we played and some of the athletes that we played against that you can remember that were very outstanding athletes from that side as well.
Okay. As far as our coaches were concerned, you know, they were educated. Our coaches, Coach Rowe, Coach Harden, Coach Clark, Coach Chapman, all these guys, I mean, they were coaches, but they were even better teachers than they were coaches. Yeah. Coach Rose, you took one of Coach Rose's class, I mean, it was a college course, you know. And he demanded the same type of excellence in his classroom that he did, you know, if you were an athlete. Coach Clark taught me chemistry, you know, and I mean, he was a good instructor. Coach Harden was a physical education instructor, but Coach Harden, everything that he did was organized, it was laid out, you know, he prepared you for it, and the same discipline he required from you on the baseball team, football team, he required you that, you know, when you came to his class. Now, as far as the other teams that we played, We played a lot of good teams that had great athletes. You know, doing even before I played, during the time that I did play. One of the guys that was one of my favorite guys to watch that came up with me was Matthew Hudson, played at Blount. And you know, he was one of these athletes that was, he was just dynamic, you know. I remember we went to see them play over at Pritchard Stadium one day. I forgot they were playing a team out of I think McKinley High. So we called him Jeff. They took him off the field on a stretcher. The first half, he said he had gotten hurt. So they took him off the field on a stretcher. So Blount got behind, and all of a sudden you heard everybody start standing up. And here he come back out of the locker room. And the first play they gave him, he went by 80 yards. And I was telling my buddy, me and Spradlin, and we went to the game. I said, man, them folks, they set them guys up. Jack wasn't hurt, man. He couldn't have been hurt. I mean, they took him off. I mean, they came out with a stretch, and, you know, it was about 10 guys taking him back to the locker room. And he didn't come back out to the fourth quarter. And, man, he cut up when he came out there, too. And but that's another thing. We used to go to each other's game. You know, if we know somebody's playing, we would go watch. Guy Williamson, Henry Hawthorne. He was kind of in the same mode that Matthew Hudson was. He had speed, you know, but he was shorter than Matthew Hudson. But he was like a bullet. I mean, he run downhill all the time, you know. And he was a very good athlete. Matter of fact, he went on up and played at Kansas State with he was in the same backfield with the guy that played with the Redskins. He's in the Hall of Fame.
Not Mitchell.
No, I can't think of his name. But he played with the Jets first, and then he came with
Wasn't that Brown?
I can't forget his name. But he played. Okay. John Riggins. John Riggins. That's what it was. Well, John Riggins.
Yeah. Riggins.
Yeah, he played with John Riggins up there. Then he went and played in Canada. But he was kind of short guy. But that's one of the guys. And then we played, you know, Sugar Man. Sugar Man was a good athlete in at Central. You know, it was just a lot of good athletes around town. And a lot of them went on and played in college, and a lot of them didn't.
Is there anything that you would like to share that we haven't talked about, or you could think about? And especially in terms of, we've talked in the past about the generation now, mm-hmm. and how little they know about this history. Is there some things you'd like to share that you want them to hear that otherwise wouldn't be said?
Well, the main thing is that we hope that they look beyond where they are right now. You know, it's not bad to go back and look at things, because that's what, you know, keeps us going. That's what tells us what to look forward to in the future. You know, if you go back and think about some of the things that not necessarily that happened to you, but things that happened way beyond where you are now, or way beyond. You know, what people have told you, you know, you go back and look at how you got to where you are right now, you know, and things like this. If we can, it's we can say it's only athletics, but it's more than just athletics, you know. It's a lifestyle. It's how people live, what people did, how people had to endure, you know, and everybody. Everybody has to go through it, you know, not just black folks, but everybody has to go through. You got to endure different times, different things, and, you know, different ways of life. But the main thing is just try to put yourself in a situation where you understand what people go through. You're tolerable of different things, and you know, you can't put yourself in a different place than other people are. You know, we're all trying to do the same thing. We're just trying to live, you know. So as long as you can do that, it doesn't matter, you know, where you came from, you know, who brought you there or what. It's just, you know, we all just need to try to understand each other and do the right thing. That's what my creed is. I just want to do the right thing.
Mr. Shears, did you, you know, when you went to Missouri, mm-hmm. that was the first time you had other white students in your class. Mm-hmm. Is that also the first time you played against white students?
Yes, that was the first time. Yeah, because we didn't have any kind of athletic, anything athletic with any of the schools around there. Even we didn't have kids that we, you know, we played with, you know, in the area that we came from. But like I said,
did you think anything of it being on the field with other white athletes at that time?
No. Because one thing about when you're on the field, it doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter. And that's one thing that helped me get through that whole process is, you know, if you're competing, you know, sports wise, then the other things, you know. You dealt with because I went to school to but mainly as an athlete, but you know you have to become a student also. So becoming a student was just something that I had to do. Once I got in the classroom, you know, it wasn't the same type of competitiveness, but you know you still competing. You know when you're in the classroom, so I take the same energy I took out on the field. That's the same energy I had in the classroom, you know, because the main thing is in the classroom, it's not a team sport. You're there by yourself, you know, on athletics, mostly, you know, it's a team thing.
How much do you think sports led to your success in the rest of your life?
Well, it helped me in terms of being able to get along with people, being able to tolerate things that you didn't have control over, you know, and you know, it made me more patient, and it also just made me know that anything that you're trying to do, you gotta work at, you gotta work to do it. That's athletics or whatever, and that's the main thing that I gather from sports is, you know, you gotta depend on other people in order to get where you're trying to get.
Larry, you got the rise for being an outstanding athlete. What kind of influence did the community have on you? The people who were, you know, behind you and mm-hmm. who weren't out in the spotlight, those who were behind pushing mm-hmm. you. What kind of influence did the community have in your success?
It had a great deal of influence because, you know, in our community. And when I say our community, I'm talking about the Magazine, Plateau, Happy Hill, Chickasaw Terrier, all of the county community, Sierra Land. Athletics was a big deal for this community. You know, we didn't have a college team here. We didn't have a professional team. So sports was something that all communities got in, you know, with their high school teams, but. Here in this area, I mean, if you were an athlete, I walked to school every day of my life, so I had to walk past the community. When I walk down the street, I'm passing by somebody's house, you know, grown people's house, and those are the people who knew who I was. You know, those are the people that spread the word about our team, and not only an athlete, but you know, the kids in our community, they were important, you know, and the people in the community, they saw you just about every day. So if you did something athletically, then, you know, that just even put a bigger spotlight on you. So these people, man, I'm telling you, we can go to the people's houses to eat, you know, after a football game or the next day, they, you know, we go by their house, they feed us. I go to the barber shop. I want to pay for my haircut. You know, I mean, That was a big deal, man. That was a big deal. I mean, it was amazing. It was amazing how much of support our community gave us, you know. And not only that, the support was that you had to do the right thing also, because I don't care where you are or what you were doing, somebody saw you, and you didn't want to, you know, some negative information getting back to your parents. So the community is what made us. The community is what drove us, because we wanted to do the right thing in our community. We wanted our community, not only our parents, but the people in our community, we wanted to make them proud of who we were. And that's what we did.
And Larry, you mentioned about going to the barbershop, mm-hmm. especially Eddie Rigsby, after a game.
Yeah. Right.
Was every play played in that barbershop the next day?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Some of them didn't even go to the game, but they knew everything that happened in the game, you know. And then they replayed it, the good and the bad. You know, they replayed everything, man. And me and Theodore Spradley, we used to, during the summer, we hung out at the barbershop. We get up in the morning, the barbershop open at 9 o'clock, we at the barbershop. And we sit around all day just listening to the talking at the barbershop, man. You know, you learn a lot when you're at the barbershop. And it was Eddie Rigsby's barbershop that we hung out at. So it was a good thing. But getting back to the community was great, man. It was, you know, you couldn't have a better community behind you, if you were an athlete.
One last question I'd like to ask and just have you elaborate on is that one of our biggest games of the year was Central and County, mm-hmm. Thanksgiving Day. From the perspective, from the standpoint of what that game meant to you from a traditional standpoint, and what that game meant to the community from a traditional standpoint.
Well, even before I played in it, you know, it was a big game for us, because it was a day that, you know, you get dressed up, you go to the game.
And when you say get dressed up,
the people went to that game like it was a rock and roll show. You know, they put their best stuff on. Some people bought stuff specifically for the game to go. And it was a big day, you know. And that was another reason I wanted to play football, because I wanted to play in that game, you know, I'm telling you, it was a big deal. It was a big deal. And once you had gone to the game, you see how big of a deal it was. Because, I mean, the stadium was packed, you know, people are everywhere. I mean, from all different parts of town. Not only people from downtown and Magdalene Plateau, but people from, they went to other schools wanting to go to that game, because it was Thanksgiving Day and it was basically something to do. And it was a gala. It really was. It was a gala. And not only that, it was good competition, good football being played that day too. Because most of the times, County and Central had very good football teams. You know, I mean, our senior year, we were 9-0, and Central, we were 8-0, and Central was 8-1. And so, I mean, we got a lot of publicity from that game because of the two teams were there, but you know. It was the same situation. A lot of people came, and they got to see a good football game.
There was one other aspect about that particular game, and I think both of us played in that game, and mm-hmm. others played in that game. That was one of the few games that I noticed a number of whites coming to the game.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And sitting in a specific location at that game every year.
Right. I heard someone say that there was a particular area that they sat in, you know. And I do remember a lot of white people coming to the game, you know, but it was all on, they were mostly all on the other side, you know, but they realized that it was some pretty good football. They were there because it was a good football team playing, you know, and eventually, if you like sports, then regardless of who's playing, you know, you'll come to see them.
one of the other things I heard about that particular game is that if somebody wanted to rob Magazine Plateau and Pritchard and Chickasaw Terrace, they could do it on that day.
Oh yes, oh yeah, because everybody went to the game, man. It was amazing, man. I'm telling you, it was. You wake up in the morning, you couldn't wait to get started. You couldn't wait to get started to go to the game. You know, especially if you played in it, you know, it was even bigger because you know the tradition. The tradition was it was a Turkey Day Classic, and that was. Regardless of how you did the whole year, that was the big. That was your biggest game, the Turkey Day Classic.
Is there anything you would like to say in closing?
Well, yes. I appreciate the opportunity to come here and share my experiences with you all, and with hopefully a whole lot of more people can share them also. And I too, along with everybody else, appreciate this opportunity, and I hope it has a positive effect on our community.